Thank you, Chris. If you tell me more about the relationship with an advance, a recent investigation that I'm here. Well, you know, it's a cliche, but not necessarily about having the White House is just the coolest thing that inside seat of history, especially key policies and history on there. So we told you this to get a little bit dirty, but we have to, especially when we're using this back and say, and how is that going to affect the industry? We're probably going to have a lot of people see them. I was in the restroom every day. And it is a cliche, but it's a big memory. There's a flip side of that, though, about some of the White House issues. You know, Harry Truman, I believe, was Harry Truman called the White House the crown jewel of the federal penitentiary, because he felt so suffocated. It's true of being a reporter, though, as well. It tends to draw the most ambitious and some of the most talented reporters in Washington. You get to the White House and you discover that there's 100 people facing the same story. And these 6 points with no explanation, and they won't talk to you. And then you're being sent around to pressers or sending you into photo ops and like chat on the street. And especially while you're doing it, but it's such to be the one downside of it. Yeah, so I was at the White House from 1993 to 1995 for 3 years. So actually, I did do some backup work with Georgia study and even around Bergen. I wasn't assigned to the White House until September 19th. So my art there was basically healthcare reform, welfare, whitewater, a series of overseas. Like Somalia and Bosnia, some of the wars in those countries. And of course, the election of Bush in 94 and the running for election, the takeover of Congress and the running for election. So that was the event that happened during that period. But we got the big library right here full of information about that. So I'm not going to talk about the policies. I do have some memories that stand out. One of the when I first got to be president of the White House, it was late spring of summer of 93. And I found about midway through the week, usually we could publish on Saturday. We would, our work week was Monday to Saturday. And we tend to plan our stories up on Monday and Tuesday, and then things on Thursday, and things on Friday, and then on Thursday. And about Wednesday, I noticed that through the course of my regular reporting, I had a lot of information about things that have been going on in the White House for the previous 4 or 5 days, sort of backstories and what we call TikTok. Exchanges back and forth. I wish I could remember what the substance was. I couldn't actually find the article in the last couple of days when the numbers figured. But I went to my board chief and I said, I got all this information and it doesn't really amount to a story on any one of these things. So we talked a bit and we called over to the junior moderator, who was the press secretary, and David Gordon, who was new over there to help with communications, and proposed that we do a week inside the White House, since I had half a week already. And they agreed on Friday night at 7 p.m. or so, with my colleague on our trip and David Gordon's office in Boston, the West Wing. And the story from their holes, and we're going to produce this sort of texting story about 1 week inside the White House. So this is, you know, there's a lot of hunger. Clinton was still new, there'd been some missteps in the first 6 months. People are very interested in the dynamics. And the phone rings, and Jordan brings us, he says, come on, let's go. And they're walking up, and I have no idea where he's going. So they got some sort of mask in the building. And he brings us upstairs, and we walk into the door where President Clinton and Michael Sullivan and George Stephanopoulos are waiting. And so my first one-on-one, or my first two-on-one with the president, was something I had no preparation for. I had no idea I was even going to do it. So that memory stands out. I went through the public story that week called 7 days, a week inside the Clinton White House. The other memories that would stand out, a couple of others, had to do with overseas travel. We were in the Middle East. I believe it was in the fall of 95, I think, the president was going to a bunch of countries in the Middle East. And we'd been in Syria, where one official who was on the surface of had a long meeting with Hafez al-Assad, the president of Syria. And we get back on the Air Force One, and I'm in the press tour, which means I'm in the tight area of reporters that stay with the president, while the vast number of reporters are following on the press card. In fact, you see the mixture, we didn't even go to Syria, because it's such a short trip, simply stayed in Israel. And that's a matter of rotation, you didn't even have to go to some friends and rotation. So we get back, we're back on the Air Force One, on the way to Tel Aviv, and the anticipator is briefing the five of us in the pool in the White House, in the Air Force One conference room. And in the middle of this, the door to the conference room comes open, and six of the senior staff come in, led by the president, carrying a big suitcase. It was one of Christopher's 70th birthday, and we stop in the middle of this briefing, sing happy birthday. Just touch the case into little pieces and put them onto little tiny paper plates, and we all sit around and celebrate his birthday, and then the guy and I are back to half a fire side. So that one stands out. And one other overseas memory, it was on a trip to Eastern Europe, and it was right after Gingrich had been, right after the GOP takeover of Congress. And we were in Belarus, and I was in the queue again, and we were ahead of the president. He's about to land, and there's going to be the airport in Minsk, and there's going to be a joint news conference with Clinton and the president of Belarus. And this is a country brand new to capitalism, just throughout the socialism with the Soviet Union, former Soviet satellite. The desperate to sort of figure out these sort of 3 months of capitalism. And there is a sign on the back of the airport wall, from the hangar wall, over the behind the port, you know, maybe 20 feet behind. It's an ad, it's quite a large sign for Pentecost Camp. And the young person who wants that, the event or the access to his contact, and said, we can use that sign. We have to move that sign. It's in the camera set. that they pay. We receive money, so we find it's probably money to run the military. And so there's a quite a bit of back and forth. And you know the story ends, of course. It has to be escalated to a senior person in the Belarus government who agrees to remove the sign or the president won't come and talk to them. And that's what happens. I remember that week very well, and actually the president was on very soon, he did my way to the house, and you can actually read a lot about this in the very first book from my time, that's the associate, but I was after very soon, I had a meeting with him, and I had no idea that my society had received the word that the very time that I had been to Bali with him, and he was going to talk to the president, and that's why he, he was afraid that CNN would get a wide story from anything. So the president, of course, becomes the first time that he really had a story that affects him in his interview. And then he saw my sign, so he just said something. So that ended, and the part of course is that people have been driving by the story at the time, but the president and then he said that they had to do my role came in just, not only that James Lance as a reporter, he was not the kind of person that they could have to talk and trust, but I had seen him on some of the first occasions. And it was just the first sort of, sort of tragedy of it. And then, of course, in that Whitewater environment, the second one was, okay, let me know, there's something going on here in that moment of time. And, what I learned during that week, the first word officially out of the White House was, we have no idea what's coming. It just came out of nowhere. And when you talk to enough people who knew him well, the Alexandrians in the White House and back in Little Rock, it was clear that he was very disturbed by what the president and the first lady were being put to do on Whitewater. He thought it was his fault. The Wall Street Journal editorial was literally from the time we had a lead of speaking to one of the exact things that my brother had had. And so, what I mostly remember is a chance to sort of lift the lid on this very human, event. And also the aftermath where everyone said, a week later they found a note torn up in the briefcase, and then they found sort of things up like one note scattered to the ground, and the press release had to be enforced, and it got to be a little bit, quite a bit of politics for them because it was clear that it was a suicide after the whole time. And it was tragic. Well, what I was imagining about the way technology is going to be in the world, what I was imagining about the technology itself, about the impact of technology in the world, principally about the impact on business, on science, and on pop culture, but in fact, when it's tested on those words, what about the impact of technology on everything, on arts and architecture, on politics, and sports, on business, in medicine, on health, and that's what we write about. But let me give you a little bit of that story in the way itself, because it's just left an answer, though. It was founded in 93 by this husband and wife who was on an album called Electric Wave in the Netherlands, and they came back to the U.S. Went around to get some money and started the album. And this was 1993, this is pre-internet, I mean, the internet existed, but it was basically without an application. Pre-MP3, there's not so pre cell phone, but my cell phone in 1993 looks like my laptop cell phone, my laptop. So it's very early, and lived with that away from the first. Is that better than this? Right from the first issue, that they're going to, that the coming digital revolution is going to be like an entire cartoon. And it was prophetic, and Lloyd doing very well, they had a set out of the group, and then the purchase by Tyler Lance, the magazine company that owns the New York City Bird and Valley Show, and the Grammar and the Lure, and one of the people that I've come over to. Purchased by Tyler Lance in 1998. Joining the board, and I think it was great. And then I came over in 2001, and a measure of what had happened during that 2000-2001 period, I was at a little magazine called the Industry Standard, between the same thing that I did between the others. The Industry Standard was a weekly magazine that was devoted to coverage of the internet each time you just found it, as businesses just about the internet, and then that ecosystem. In the year 2000, the Industry Standard sold more ad pages than any magazine in the history of American publishing. 7,000 ad pages, which is a weekly. And the year 2001, the Industry Standard didn't think that. So that was sort of the story of the big bust right there. So I came over road, and we had sort of a rough path right off the bat because there was, you go back to 2001, there was a time of some argument about whether there was a socialized economic system in 1900s, but they clearly advertised the system, they clearly technology structured the system. Until 9/11, and nobody cared much about poor cell phones. And we had a whole new management team there, too. So we sort of had a dip in sales, a dip in trying to figure out what we were about. And then until 9/11, the management team didn't really have since 2002. No, it's just a magazine. Well, it's a generalist magazine. It's just an idea magazine. They're an idea-driven magazine. We're about to really take my ideas changing things. Changing the world that we all live in. So, my experience is more people in higher years, for those of you who have never seen a magazine before, imagine that it was a magazine on computers. When you go to the magazine store at the airport, and I went back, I would find it sort of wrapped with computer magazines. In some places. Some places you find it out there sort of PC and Instagram, so there's some guys that use it. And sometimes you'll find it in Forbes and Forbes and Business Week, which is a business magazine. I suppose they look at Forbes because it's a science magazine. They don't know where to put it. Most of you voted first after the Florida and the hearing said that it was expanded. So you voted in the same group. And, the irony is that the computer scientists were saying, and I said, well, yeah, but there's a part of the world that's going on. And the voters imagined, I want an ATM machine to vote on. I can get my bank, my money out of the bank, why can't I vote on the same machine? And it's been, the technologists have been putting the brakes on, and the voters and the politicians have been saying we need to do this. And this, in 12 days, 40% of the Americans will vote on touchscreen and other electronics, which is called DIE, direct report election devices, I think is what the other thing for. And most of them for the first time. And we think they work, we think they are good. I'm not raising the, there are some conspiracy theories out there who think they're not working. I'm not one of them, but they're still open questions, and I think there was a commission with Jimmy Carlin and Jim Baker last year that the trial they're doing to be, they sort of confirmed the commission is, and we even have paper records of these studies. And the question is, technologically, how do we take the records? So, in any event, we're heading that way very quickly. And, you know, I think when we get the info back from the tech standpoint, it's a fantastic news because, you know, we have data come out, you know, which is somewhere below 50%. Anything we can do to make very, very convenient and more ubiquitous. I mean, I don't think it'll be in my lifetime, I believe, that we'll be voting on traffic. We'll be voting for my time to do. I'm just thinking I love it. Let me go back to topics, I think that's right. Even cars and everything like that. All these tools of the old way of doing things. So I think the internet is permanently entrenched as an early tool from the collection of politics. The world of God is kind of being stories about in his book, and I see a year before. But he's got a broader take on the areas and the impact of the internet on so many industries that we live in that are out of right now is that it removes filters, it removes layers, it's the third budget of digital mediation, it's just going to remove the middleman, it removes the mediator. So it happens in politics where voters and politicians are much closer to each other. You've got politicians doing video grabbing, you know, they're taking video to put it on the site and getting much closer to voters. I think that in politics, you're seeing this intermediation, and in the context of this, you're seeing it in the best other industries as well. You're seeing it in the music industry, you're seeing it in real estate. There's a couple of websites I can point to that completely are offending these industries. That's the biggest story of 2006. And we can talk about YouTube in particular, but broadly, those things that you mentioned, YouTube, Facebook, MySpace, other sites like Flickr and Wikipedia, this is, both of you, the followers of those know, these are the websites that were defined, it's called Web 2.0, the second era of the internet, or the World Wide Web. And you can have a lot of people online that are trying to explain and argue what that word means. To me, what it means is the rise of user-generated content. The content comes from all you guys, not from the same media professional, but the content comes from everybody else. YouTube, the videos come from the community. MySpace, from the community. Wikipedia is people out there in the world putting up, helping create 1 billion entries on Wikipedia. particularly if it's a photo sharing site, the same thing. The content isn't made by content professionals. You know, it's called the rise of the amateurs. And it is across the board having a big impact. And the big companies, the big media companies, have been taking notice. YouTube just got bought by Google for $1.6 billion. MySpace got bought by Google late afternoon for $6 billion. And then in the last month, there have been reports that Yahoo is on Facebook, I think between $1 and $2 billion. These are companies that have made me money in the past. But I think there's more logic here than there was 5 years ago. Probably I'm going to tell you what that is, huh? Okay, so what does Google have to do to get their money back on YouTube? They have to figure out how to integrate story, they can monetize the eyeballs, right? But the eyeballs are there. 100 million streams come out of YouTube every day. 100 million, that isn't 100 million people. Let's just say the average person is watching 4 videos. Only 25 million people are watching videos, either on YouTube or a YouTube video embedded in another website, which is often how you're finding. 70,000 uploads every day. 70,000 people, 70,000 videos are being uploaded to YouTube every single day. There is a lot of energy around these sites. 6 years ago, we would have said, how are they going to monetize those eyeballs? We would have said, don't know. Now we know, because Google has created an advertising system to sell ads on the web. You know, it's not our fault, so they can match the content to where you are through this keyword algorithm. And it is worth brilliantly in print, and the question is, can it work with video, either with video or with photographs? And I think Google's bet is that they have the smartest software engineers in the world and they can make it work. But that is a gamble because if you're the person who uploads that video of the cat, you know, your cat doing something cute, which is what most of the videos are on YouTube, you tag it yourself. You put the little words in and you're like, you know, my pet cat. Which is good if Yamas wants to turn around and sell an ad, they're going to have plenty of things to sell it, and so they can match those things up. You also put good reviews on there because that's the way they make sure the video is good. Everyone has it. Well, it really is good reviews. But when they can figure out how to create a tagging system that actually matches, that tells you what the video content is, and then they can sell it, that's for someone who wants to reach a viewer of that kind of content. So I've done the same thing we've done in print, and I think it'll pay. Well, we were talking about the paper. I think newspapers are in real trouble due to the internet for two very different and big reasons. They're losing readers, and they're losing money. Readership is losing newspapers and going to the internet and going to cable television, the revenue is way up. The newspaper industry is a business, it's in crisis right now. And it's off, I was looking at this, there's no Craigslist in Little Rock, but does some of you know what Craigslist is? Craigslist is this completely nice Mormon guy named Craig Newmark in San Francisco, who has single handedly, with only a small graduation, decimated the newspaper industry. He's created Craigslist, which is on 50 cities in the U.S. and in 50 countries. And it is the most, the best classified ad. I'm so too tired to Craigslist. My wife has hired music teachers for her music school for Craigslist. All transactions occur. Things you need to use newspaper classified ads. The classified ads in newspapers are 40% of newspaper revenue. And I don't know what the number is, but I bet it's down to 10% or 15%. So newspapers are a real trouble for losing readers and losing revenue. Magazines, some trouble for sure, but not so much for the exact same reasons, but because there's more competition for people coming. People are not reading as much, or because they're on the internet and they're playing video games and they're watching by themselves or cable television. And there's a secular decline in magazine readership, but not really. Is newspapers, but there's a small decline I'm happy for the way that we could be going up, but we're not really going to change the overall plan. I really think that clearing up is what 2.0 means. This user-generated, peer-to-peer revolution is going to be the story for the next few as well. In a different world, I think you're seeing new technologies come to the energy realm. We have the one Middle East, we have high gas prices. And now we have a lot of alternatives. You know, people have been about wind and solar for 30 years, but they now have just infrastructure solar. It's definitely making economic sense. And maybe for hybrid power, I'm one of many that do the wait list for the tour. They talk about ethanol and a substitute for the gas. What I think, and of course, the big one is nuclear, which is Chernobyl and Three Mile Island aside, being safe and ready. And I think that the visceral version is, I'm not a brand new guy, but a lot of former people who used to hate nuclear and they used to protest against it, and now saying that nuclear is better than solar carbon energy. So I think the energy world, in particular, is ripe for new technologies and a change in public policy coming together to see some changes in the next year. So you got the brand new issue, the new atheism, just came out about 2 days ago, and not quite up and coming, but I'll say one word about that, and then we'll talk a little bit about the future. But that's a fairly provocative subject matter for the magazine. And perhaps a little off point, you might imagine, for writing. The story here is three scientists, Richard Dawkins, Sam Harris, and Ben Bennett, who have all written screeds against religion in the last 6 months. And Dawkins and Harris are both in the Washington Post right now. And their position is that if you're a person of science, you can't be a person of faith. But usually, they don't say that. You can't, they don't go together. Now, why is the magazine of the mind, the rational thinking, they write about, it's very sort of, natural thinking. And yet, if you just realize that words are just incredibly well written story, you'll find that we conclude, I hate to ruin the ending, but it's not like a very common movie or something. We conclude that these guys are as militant and intolerant on their side as some of the very strong religious writers on their side. But it's a fascinating sort of foray into the question of whether science and religion are not incompatible. That's not really in the future yet. We'll be doing some of the stuff that we talked about with YouTube, et cetera, we'll be writing about in the December issue with a story that focuses on the similar phenomenon that probably caused YouTube, Google, to pay $100 billion for YouTube, which was this series of episodes called Learn to Grow 15. That some of you may have heard of. Learn to Grow 15 is web episode of 2 minutes in length that YouTube has been running since March, and in September they were announced as being highly produced look at a mental look on how to do it. They were so highly produced that they were effectively looking on how to do it, that's how good they were at it. By Hollywood Film and some of his partners who have the money. And the Negro 15 is now 15 year old girl, definitely only 15 being a teenager, but it's 20 year old actress, so they're hired to do it. Oddly enough, this is our best break. Oddly enough, traffic, even after this was added on a blog, traffic continued to be very, very high on that. And we had a back story on one of the other team that explained sort of how they did it. And we coupled that with a more serious story about the way that web video, YouTube and one example of web video, is changing the TV industry and will eventually expect some money out of TV advertising. The same way that newspaper ads and stuff like that, newspapers on the internet. The TV industry, I don't know if it's great for TV industry because the stories that the audience are smaller and smaller, but they keep putting the money in, they don't know what to do with it. And the best story is sort of this pivot moment right now. Thanks in December. After that, I'm something new. And just like I didn't believe you, you don't have to believe me. Interested. I mean, there are 60 million blogs. And some of them are blogs that were started and then never finished and they left them. But 4 million of them are updated at least once a week. So is it possible that, it depends on your time, if it's crazy, could 70% user generated? Maybe, but most of the guys, only those kids, most of them are going to Amazon.com and Amazon.com and eBay and other places like that. But, by that long tail, there are probably a ton of pages that are my blog about my dad. That maybe do even better pages about this. So I guess 70 doesn't surprise me. And the international question, you know, that this website called Customer Rally counts measures the blog is for number one most popular blog in the world, since the page views, is from a Chinese website. So the sound system in this phenomenon, needless to say, and Dragon and the international function, this is a bit of a free story too, but China is the place to watch. And everything, not just on the internet and variety, but in everything. And we wrote about China quite a bit, but rather than that, too, the part of our mandate is what's new and what's next. Yeah, there is a spirited debate in the journalism, the content world, which is a view on the blog, about the class system that's called MFM, mainstream media, and everybody else. And it's usually reverses one or the other. My sense is that the two are compatible. Many of us still blog, do blogs every day. I don't know how news and facts and understanding of the world that I don't have access to. And this is what they do to me at times, as I am to some guys. Some blogs are quite well informed and smart and analytical, and they're very narrow subjects. And you accept them more than the second year of times, because you've got one obsessive blog, the only blog in that season, every day. And you've got social groups all the place, because they don't have time to spend on. So if you're on your family, you go to the fifth blog, which is kind of on the side of. So I don't think that blogging or internet in general threatens the leadership of traditional, threatens the role of the traditional reporters and journalists, people still want to know whether what they're reading is accurate, has been brought together under some kind of standard, even though they're not invited to something that has some sort of written standards on it. And I think, leadership may go down in terms of numbers of hours you spend to read the newspaper managing, but I think the role of a newsroom is always really important. Yeah, well, last week Microsoft was actually because they were the Google of their time, they were the next time, they were the day that it's something that changed, and they had a hand in that place. And Microsoft is everybody's comfort now, and they're still writing software that goes in the box on the computer, and the trend is software that goes in the user for the web instead. I think they recognize this, and it's really not a good revelation for who you're going to lead. And gradually step down and be thrown to the board and work on the foundation. And I realize a guy who understands this world as sort of web-based world, of course, where there's two platforms to talk to people, the principal sort of ideas and missions of that company. So, Microsoft is trying to reinvent stuff. They want to be a little past them and they're already back. It's easy. But the lead, we were just talking the other day about the first generation of internet companies, Amazon, eBay, Yahoo, and they seem to thrive right now. We had a new situation where we found a story about that, but it's just an interesting, I really expect it's the same type of a, that can be that is old or happening. Music is a fascinating example of how the internet has completely changed an industry. In 2003, we did a cover story with the classic Led Zeppelin Hindenburg with the cover line, Rip, Mix, Burn, The Fire, the music industry. That was before MySpace even existed. That was really the music industry from public to the fashion. Now, if you look at our world now, the three things that sort of animate the music industry. One is still five for an illegal and legal. One is MP3 players like the iPod and iTunes players. And MySpace, which is, now it's like a network that began essentially for music. All three of those threaten the music power to be affected a little bit. People are downloading music the way that I've been doing. If they're going to MySpace and they're listening to music there and then downloading from there, the way that I've been doing. And radio, in response to the question, MySpace is radio is basically how music is marketed. Well, MySpace is how music is marketed. So the role of radio in marketing music is drawing out the results of the role of the labels in distributing music. And so, because of the community, distributing music. my temptations to say all of them, without being, too dystopian or anything, but it feels like, I'm not taking into the question directly, but we just talk about the music industry. I think you're right about the B2B industry, and that's just, they've definitely moved to on demand because, Netflix is only a half step to living. They sort of think of a post office that intermediates. So they're going to find a way. It's all about broadband and picking up your TV and computer and just having it in the waiting for. So, not that I can identify a brand new one, but newspapers, music, television, it's all changing. And certainly, comics. The comics thing, that was one of the first things to go with. It was more successful than Amazon, some years ago. Weird as it is, you already can in Second Life. I don't go to these. In fact, I make my favorite time in the games, and I get in private restaurant games with virtual boys. But not that I'm proud or embarrassed to say this, but Wired now has a physical space inside Second Life. Once you know there's like minutes and I jump in it. Second Life is this virtual reality. And it's been complete, all sorts of companies, you probably know about more about this language, all sorts of companies have established physical presences in Second Life. And it's you have your avatar, and you go and people spend hours, lifetimes inside this language, kind of this big world. It's in the issue before the one, it's in our cover issue. We did, Let's Go, Travel Guide or something like that, to treat it like it was a travel guide. To the 10-page rip-off of a Let's Go Europe kind of approach to explain what something like this. As a result, you don't have broadband, or you'll go to some other way. Yeah. And I'm not sure, I think the key to all this happening, especially Netflix and going on demand, is broadband penetration. Exactly how that manifests itself, I don't really know. But one of the reasons that web video worked now, and didn't work 5 years ago, is that I think 50% of American homes have broadband if they buy it for them. And no one is going to wait on a broadband to watch the images. And so I think that this is going to continue and it'll make possible a lot of the work that we're talking about and make it more difficult. And I say this as a discussion, but when I hear the phrase information management, I was just thinking about the tagging systems that have to be invented and have to work to make a lot of YouTubers. They have to be taxonomies and created, they have to be standards about how these taxonomies are going to work. And again, I think that's the biggest thing that on YouTube is that they can see the access of the site that they're doing. But I think creating these taxonomies, which I think is part of information management problem, is key to making the web 2.0 as they call it in the realm.
Yeah, I'm